Hey everyone, we are talking about commonly used sedative and neuromuscular blocking agents used during rapid sequence intubation. We will talk about their mechanism of action, doses, route, onset and duration of action, side effects, and contraindications. First, we'll talk about induction agents. Induction agent is a drug that, when given intravenously in an appropriate dose, causes a rapid loss of consciousness, analgesia, or amnesia. These agents are given as a rapid IV push immediately before paralyzing agent. The most commonly used induction agent is Etomidate. Etomidate is a potent, short-acting, non-barbiturate sedative hypnotic without analgesic properties. It depresses central nervous system function by enhancing the effects of GABA receptors. It is administered at a dose of 0.15 to 0.3 mg per kilogram IV push with a 30 to 60 seconds onset of action and a duration of 3 to 5 minutes. Since Etomidate maintains hemodynamic stability and does not induce hypertension, it is preferred to other induction agents in patients with cardiovascular disease. The side effects include nausea and vomiting, myoclonic jerks, which can be mistaken for seizures. Use caution in patients with adrenal insufficiency because Etomidate can cause adrenal suppression for 12 to 24 hours after injection. The decrease in cortisol production is due to Etomidate inhibiting 11 beta hydroxylase, a key enzyme in cortisol synthesis. This can potentially impact blood pressure in patients with pre-existing adrenal insufficiency or sepsis. Ketamine is a rapid-acting general anesthetic that produces sedation, analgesia, and amnesia by blocking NMDA receptors. The standard induction dose of ketamine is 1 to 2 mg per kilogram. It has a short onset of action of 45 to 60 seconds and anesthetic duration of action of 5 to 10 minutes. Ketamine side effects include hypertension and increased heart rate, which makes it a good choice in hemodynamically unstable patients, but it can cause hypotension in case of catecholamine depletion. It can also cause psychological side effects such as hallucination, delirium, and dreams. The psychological side effects can be minimized by pre-medicating with midazolam. Also, ketamine can cause excessive salivation, which can make intubation more difficult. Since ketamine raises blood pressure and may theoretically increase intracranial pressure, it should be avoided in patients who are hypertensive or with elevated intracranial pressure. Use caution in patients with cardiovascular disease due to ketamine's potential to induce cardiac ischemia through sympathetic stimulation. Also, ketamine has been shown to have bronchodilation effects, which can be useful in patients with asthma and/or COPD. Propofol has multiple mechanisms of action but primarily potentiate GABA receptors, causing sedation and amnesia. It is administered at a dose of 2 to 3 mg per kilogram IV push. Because it is highly lipid soluble, it induces sedation quickly within 10 to 45 seconds and has a duration of 3 to 10 minutes. Because of its quick onset of action and short half-life, propofol can also be used in post-intubation sedation as a continuous titratable infusion at a dose of 5 to 50 micrograms per kilogram per minute. The side effects include hypotension, bradycardia, and apnea. With prolonged use such as post-intubation sedation, patients may develop propofol infusion syndrome. The mechanism is now well understood, but it's a rare condition that can lead to rhabdomyolysis, cardiac failure, liver failure, kidney failure, and elevated triglycerides. Though controversial, some manufacturers list eggs and soybeans allergies as a contraindication to using propofol, as some formulations may contain these products. Propofol is a good choice for patients with traumatic brain injury and status epilepticus because it has anticonvulsive properties and reduces intracranial and intraocular pressure. Like ketamine, propofol has been shown to have bronchodilation effects, which can be useful in patients with asthma and/or COPD. Midazolam, brand name Vasidine, is a benzodiazepine that causes sedation and amnesia through its effect on the GABA receptors complex. It is the most rapidly acting benzo, commonly used for rapid sequence intubation, but uncommonly used as a sole induction agent for rapid sequence intubation due to its slower onset of action and unreliable level of sedation. If Vased is the only available option, the induction dose is 0.1 to 0.3 mg per kg with an onset of action of 60 to 90 seconds and a duration of action of 15 to 30 minutes. Co-administration with fentanyl should be considered to decrease the onset of action. The side effects include hypotension, respiratory depression, and apnea. Due to its tendency to cause hypotension, lower doses should be used in hypovolemic and elderly patients, or Etomidate or ketamine should be used. Like all benzos, Vased does not provide analgesic effect and is generally not used alone in rapid sequence intubation, but it does have anti-seizure effects, making it an effective agent for rapid sequence intubation in patients with status epilepticus. Now we will talk about neuromuscular blocking agents. Neuromuscular blocking agents cause muscle paralysis and must always be used along with an induction or sedating agent. There are two categories of neuromuscular blocking agents, depolarizing and non-depolarizing. In this video, we will talk about succinylcholine and rocuronium since they are the most used neuromuscular blocking agents in rapid sequence intubation. Succinylcholine is a depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant that blocks acetylcholine receptors. It is the most commonly used paralytic agent for rapid sequence intubation. It is administered at a dose of 0.3 to 1.5 mg per kilogram IV push with an onset of action of 30 to 60 seconds and a duration of action of 6 to 10 minutes. Side effects include bradycardia, hypotension, and hyperkalemia. Succinylcholine is contraindicated in patients with personal or familial history of malignant hypothermia. Also, certain health conditions can cause upregulation of acetylcholine receptors, resulting in life-threatening hyperkalemia. Therefore, it should be avoided in patients with systematic hyperkalemia, end-stage renal disease, rhabdomyolysis, greater than 3 days after burns or stroke, or any disease causing extensive denervation of skeletal muscles, such as multiple sclerosis or muscular dystrophy. Rocuronium, aka ROC, is a non-depolarizing neuromuscular blocking agent that competitively blocks acetylcholine receptors, causing complete muscle and respiratory paralysis. It is administered at a dose of 0.45 to 1.5 mg per kilogram IV push with an onset of action of 1 to 2 minutes, but lasts for a longer period of approximately 45 to 70 minutes, especially in patients with hepatic disease. Due to its longer duration, it is usually used when succinylcholine is contraindicated or unavailable. Prolonged paralysis can be reversed by reversal agent Sugammadex. In contrast to succinylcholine, rocuronium has no significant side effects and only one contraindication, which is history of anaphylaxis to rocuronium or other neuromuscular blocking agents. Therefore, it is often chosen in trauma patients where medical history is unknown or lab values have not resulted. Rocuronium should be used with caution in patients with predicted difficulty airway or ventilation and in patients with liver disease due to prolonged paralysis. Remember, intubated patients experience pain and anxiety, and post-intubation sedation and analgesic is necessary for patient comfort and respiratory compliance with artificial ventilation. Thank you for watching. Until next time, stay healthy and remember, health is the greatest wealth.